The following special program, Fox News Candidate Face-Off for the U.S. Senate. Please welcome moderators Robin Robinson and Walter Jacobson.
Thank you all for being here. In case you can't tell, I'm Walter of the two of us.
And I would be Robin. We want to welcome to our live two-hour U.S. Senate Candidate Forum sponsored by the NAACP Illinois State Conference.
This is a time for all of us to get to know some of the men and women who are seeking to become the U.S. Senator from the state of Illinois and where they stand on the major issues facing our state and, of course, facing the nation as well. As the most interesting thing, or one of the most pleasant things I should say about this evening, is that we will be not interrupted by commercials.
Something we're not used to, but glad about. For 67 years, the NAACP Illinois State Conference has gotten together for an annual convention. This weekend, they are meeting in Chicago. This forum is the highlight of that gathering. We have a lot of NAACP members in our audience tonight, and we'd like to welcome you all. Thank you for being here. And please join me in welcoming the president of the NAACP Illinois State Conference, Ms. Iris Johnson. Excuse me. Thanks for being here. I appreciate it. Good evening. It is with great honor that I welcome you, the candidates, our members, the studio audience, the media, and you, the viewers at home, to the Illinois NAACP State Conference U.S. Senate Candidate Forum. Tonight's program, a first for our conference and the state of Illinois, is designed to increase the knowledge, to empower our members and the general public in the political process of the local, state, and federal elections. Tonight's forum is one of many opportunities for candidates leading up to the March 16th primary election. In the best interest of promoting voter registration and involvement, we encourage every citizen to learn about all of the candidates running in all of the races in the upcoming primary election. On behalf of all of our members, I wish to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for being here.
Now we would like to introduce 11 Senate candidates who are about to face off in what we hope will be a provocative and enlightening exchange of ideas. We will begin alphabetically and then alternate between parties.
That's right. You don't know the length we've gone to be fair. None of this is our choice. It's all been by lottery and by chance and not your decision or my decision, right? I'm going to begin with Republican candidate General John Borling, a Southsider. Mr. Borling spent 37 years in the U.S. Air Force, 6.5 of those years as a POW in Vietnam. Formerly president of Chicago's United Way, he also helped found the Chicago Military Academy, Bronzeville. He's now chairman of an energy services company, and Mr. Borling and his wife of 40 years live in Rockford.
Let's cross over to the Democratic side now and go to Gary Chico, who has served as chief of staff, as you may know, to Chicago's Mayor Richard Daley. Those were between the years 1992 and 1995. After that, he was president of the Chicago Board of Education and helped lead what he describes as the turnaround of the public school system. Mr. Chico is an attorney and is active in the Boys and Girls Club of Chicago.
And next, Republican candidate John Cox. Mr. Cox was born in Chicago and raised by a single mother on the south side of the city. He says his upbringing gives him a unique perspective on working hard to succeed. He calls himself a true conservative. If elected, Mr. Cox would be the first certified public accountant voted into the U.S. Senate.
The Democrat candidate Blair Hull, a businessman who served in the U.S. Army and been a public high school teacher in his past, he says that if he's elected, he will bring what he describes as real-life experience and an independent voice to Washington. Mr. Hull says he will fight against corporate special interests and for American working families.
Republican candidate Andrew McKenna. Mr. McKenna is president of Schwartz Paper Company. He and his wife Mary have four children and live in Glenview, Illinois. Mr. McKenna earned his bachelor's degree from the University of Notre Dame and his master's degree from Northwestern University's Kellogg School of Management. Throughout his career, Mr. McKenna has been active in a number of civic, business, and charitable organizations.
The Democrat Dan Hynes, now in his second term as comptroller of the state of Illinois, aiming, he says, to protect consumers, to crack down on corporate abuse, and as he puts it, to stand up for the working men and women of this state. If he's elected, says Mr. Hynes, he will change what he describes as misguided priorities in government and politics.
Republican candidate James Oberweis. Mr. Oberweis is chairman of Oberweis Dairy and Oberweis Asset Management. He ran for the U.S. Senate last year and calls himself a fiscally responsible, pro-life Catholic candidate. Mr. Oberweis is the father of five children and a former junior high school teacher.
Democrat State Senator Barack Obama, who has been in the state Senate now for 7 years. He's married and the father of two children and a professor of constitutional law at the University of Chicago. Mr. Obama was the first African-American ever to serve as editor of the Harvard Law Review. The Democrat Nancy Skinner, who describes herself as a lifelong advocate of progressive causes. She has a business degree from the University of Michigan and is now a nationally syndicated radio talk show host and a frequent contributor to the political debates on CNN, MSNBC, and the Fox News Channel.
Republican candidate Jack Ryan. Mr. Ryan was an investment banker for 15 years before making a very dramatic career change. He has spent the last 3 years teaching at Hales Franciscan, an all-African-American parochial school on Chicago's South Side. Mr. Ryan lives in Wilmette and has a 9-year-old son.
Democrat candidate Joyce Washington, a graduate of the University of Evansville with a degree in nursing. She has held management positions with several healthcare organizations and is now a healthcare executive. Ms. Washington ran for lieutenant governor last year. If elected to the U.S. Senate, she says that she will fight for healthcare reform and family issues.
Well, we don't know if you just accept. Yes, let's give our candidates a round of applause for being here. We appreciate it. We don't know if you guys that are out there in this TV audience just happened to tune in or if you've been looking forward to this all week. Either way, we hope you will find it fulfilling. I know that not everybody's like Walter, for whom politics is as exciting as it is important. But do think about how cool it's going to feel to go into the voting booth and actually know something about the folks whose names are on the ballot. And in this case, looks like there are going to be a lot of names on the ballot, and there's certainly going to be a lot at stake. Tonight, our political correspondent, Jack Conaty, is another one of those people who lives for the election season. He's going to be joining us throughout with some insight into the issues that really do affect all of us. Jack.
Thank you, Robin. We thought we'd start tonight with a look at what's at stake in this campaign and give you some background on why there are so many candidates on this stage. The U.S. Senate has been called the most exclusive club in the world, and it has long been the province of millionaires, even billionaires, although not every member is wealthy. The Senate was designed by the founding fathers to be the deliberative body and to shield its members from the pressures of populism. Senators serve 6-year terms. There are 2 senators from each state, and currently Illinois has 1 Democrat, Dick Durbin, and 1 Republican, Peter Fitzgerald. The Senate is very closely divided. There are 51 Republicans, 48 Democrats, and 1 independent who normally votes Democrat. The White House was so concerned about holding Peter Fitzgerald's seat when he retires that it tried to recruit former Governor Jim Edgar to run. Edgar declined, so the field to replace Fitzgerald is now wide open in both parties. And it's not just control of the Senate at stake. Fitzgerald's successor could well determine the fate of another Fitzgerald, Patrick, who now serves as U.S. Attorney in Chicago. His aggressive prosecutions of corruption have upset politicians in both parties here, and Peter Fitzgerald considered his appointment his most controversial decision in 6 years in office.
Look at it, I'm not.
Jack, thank you. The NAACP Illinois wants to give the candidates time to share their views and to give voters an opportunity to hear where each of them stands on a wide range of topics. A set of criteria was established to narrow the field. 6 candidates in each party were deemed by the NAACP as eligible to participate in this forum. One of the Republicans, Mr. Steven Rauschenberger, withdrew from the forum, which is why tonight we have 6 Democrats and only 5 Republicans.
And we've made an allowance for that. The questions for tonight's forum were researched by the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Center for Governmental Studies and edited by Fox News. There will be 6 rounds of questions. Each candidate will have 30 seconds to answer 1 question in each round. Now, we held a lottery to decide the order in which the candidates are going to take the questions. The last 2 candidates in each round are going to be asked to come to the podium here for a face-off question. It's going to be a little bit different. They'll have a little bit longer to answer, and that question's going to come from an audience member. They'll have 45 seconds to answer, and here's where they're going to get time for a rebuttal to the opposing person answering.
Got all that? Here's a little more. Following the question and answer segments, each candidate will present a two-minute closing statement. So, to get started, Jack will now set up our first topic, being the Iraq and the war on terrorism. Jack?
Walter, our first topic this evening took center stage on September 11, 2001. The war on terrorism is the centerpiece of the Bush presidency. And the White House says the front line in that war is Iraq. The White House calls the war in Iraq, along with the continuing conflict in Afghanistan, the front line in the war on terror. But recent polls indicate Americans have become divided on the issue. Increasing casualties and skyrocketing costs have raised questions about how the Bush administration is handling the so-called post-war situation. Americans worry about an open-ended commitment of blood and treasure in a Vietnam-like scenario. Iraq is taxing the all-volunteer military, and the demands on the National Guard and reserves are virtually unprecedented. In Afghanistan, there are continued American casualties and some evidence that the Taliban is regrouping. Questions about the whereabouts of Saddam Hussein and the weapons of mass destruction are all unresolved. Closer to home, Americans remain concerned about homeland security. Local governments have been hard hit financially by a series of heightened but non-specific terror alerts. And billions in federal funds have yet to make it to many American cities. Airport security has proved burdensome and uneven, and many Americans are concerned about a loss of civil liberties. The feds say there are al-Qaeda sleeper cells in the country that the FBI hasn't found. And Osama bin Laden is apparently alive and well and still threatening Americans both here and abroad.
Thank you very much, Jack. I know you tried your best to be cheerful on that subject. And now the candidates are going to each have the chance to answer a question related to the war against terrorism and Iraq. Remember, you have 30 seconds to complete your response. And as I said earlier, by lottery, we decided who is going to go first, and it's going to begin with the Republican side. And I'm going to begin with Mr. Oberweis. Mr. Oberweis, in your opinion, is this country safer because the United States invaded Iraq?
Robin, I would say that we definitely are safer today than we were at that time. We've made a great stride in going forward in trying to end the terrorism that has occurred and the danger that has occurred. I think there's still more to be done. I think we must see this through. But so far, I think we're going in the right direction. There's a ways to go, but things are looking much better. And I think we'll continue to do the right things and to free people in Iraq and Afghanistan.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Royce. Walter?
Mr. Hines, do you think that the invasion of Iraq was justified?
I supported the removal of Saddam Hussein. I think the world is a safer place as a result. My greatest disappointment in the fact that so many Americans are angry is because this administration had no plan to finish the job, to rebuild Iraq, to secure the peace, to bring the international community into this process. And we're paying the price in terms of lives lost and dollars spent. We're spending over $1 billion a week in Iraq, and there's no plan to finish the job. We need to finish the job, get the world community involved, and bring our troops home.
Thank you, sir. Robin?
And now, Mr. McKenna. Do you support the president's request for additional funding for Iraq, $87 billion?
I do support the president's request for additional funding for Iraq. I think it's most important that we support our troops that are on the ground in Iraq, and we must do whatever it takes to support them. It's also important that we take those actions that are necessary to see to it that we arrive at a stable and free and democratic Iraq, and when we get there, our chances for world peace are greatly enhanced.
Okay, thank you very much for your answer. Walter.
Mr. Hull, will U.S. military actions in Iraq, do you think, keep the terrorists from our shores?
Well, Walter, I spent 4 years in the military, and I do know that you need to, the first rule that you learn in the military is you don't put your men in harm's way, except at the last resort. I believe that we are not as safe at home here as we would have been if we had not invaded Iraq. I believe that we needed a coalition. I believe that we needed UN support prior to that. If we think about the 91 war, we had a coalition that included Arab nations, and as a result, we were less of a target for terrorism.
I certainly don't want to be impolite, but because of the number and the time shortage, I may just have to cut you off mid-sentence. Robin?
Thank you very much. Mr. Borling, has the war in Iraq detracted from efforts to catch Osama bin Laden?
I don't think so. I was speaking to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff shortly after the announced cessation of formal hostilities and said, you know, the hard part starts now, Dick. And he said, yeah, that's true. And in response to those who don't think we had a plan, we in fact do have a plan. It's just going to take us longer than we want. We're an impatient people, but we've got to stay the course. I really think the cut and run crowd need to think about the investment we've already made and the change we're going to make in the world. And we'll get Osama bin Laden. It's a matter of time.
Okay. Thank you very much, Walter.
Mr. Chico, is preemptive military action a sound foreign policy, do you think, in this age of terrorism?
Only when you have an increased standard of proof to show that there's an imminent threat to the United States of America, which was not the case with Iraq, from my estimation. We were told that there were weapons of mass destruction, and that to deal with that, we would take an international force into that country to deal with it. We did not meet the standard, in my view, and therefore it was not applied correctly.
Thank you. Ms. Washington, a colored code system to screen all airline passengers is expected to go into effect next year. Do you think that's a good idea?
You know, we have been looking at all of these different kinds of things that they want to put into effect next year. I think it's probably not a good idea when you look at all the civil liberties that we are giving up. If you look at the Patriot Act, you look at some of the other things, I think we ought to be very, very careful before we start color coding and before we start doing some of the things that we're talking about doing. So I would say that would not be.
Okay, thank you, Robin.
And now, Mr. Ryan, is the federal government providing enough money for Homeland Security?
I think that it is. The first role of government is to make sure that our children and our families are safe from harm. 3,000 children came home today and didn't find a parent there to greet them because of the events of 9/11. We've got to do whatever it takes, I think, to make sure that our children and our family are safe. And I think so far it seems as if, since there's been no attacks since 9/11, that we're doing that. And I'd do whatever it takes to make sure that our homeland is safe.
Okay. Thank you very much. Walter.
Ms. Skinner, if you had been in the Senate last year, would you have voted in favor of the resolution justifying the invasion of Iraq?
No, Walter. I would not have voted for the resolution for this war. I believe that Bush's war in Iraq has made us less secure than we were before the war. 6 months, $600 million later, David Kaye, the chief weapons inspector, has now said he has found no weapons of mass destruction. Even President Bush has admitted there's no link between Osama bin Laden and Saddam Hussein. Al-Qaeda's recruiting efforts have been boosted by this war in Iraq, and North Korea has gotten the message of preemptive war. Get a bomb and get it quick. I would not have voted for it, and I think I would have asked more strongly. The media should have answered it. I would have asked those questions before the war.
Thank you very much. Now we're going to go to our first face-off, and we're going to invite the final two candidates, those who did not answer these questions that were just put here, to come forward, Mr. John Cox from the Republican side, and Mr. Barack Obama from the Democratic side. And gentlemen, while you're at the podiums, this question, as we said, is going to come from the audience. And Jack is with our first audience member with a question. Jack.
Robin, thank you. Our first guest is Charles McCain from LaGrange. Mr. McCain.
Good evening. I'm a retired command sergeant major from the U.S. Army. I have great concern for our involvement in Iraq. The question I have for you tonight is, what would you do to speed up the turnover of power from the coalition to the Iraqi people?
And Mr. Cox has the first reply. I meant to tell you that before.
The people of Iraq have been through a very chilling experience. First of all, they lived for 20 years under a brutal regime. 300,000 Iraqis lost their lives, and 5,000 Iraqi children each month lost their lives as well. I think the first thing that we have to do is get their oil flowing so they can support themselves, and I favor that very completely. I think they also need a structure, a tax system, a legal system. Any good functioning government needs the rule of law, needs a police and a military as well to protect the peace. I think the president is working on these. I think he did have a plan, and they are executing it. It takes a little while. It's only been a few months. I think the American people need to be patient with that process.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cox. And now, Barack Obama, the same question. What would you do to speed up the process of getting the power to the people of Iraq?
Well, first of all, Robin, I think that it's important to note that many of the issues that have been raised now with respect to whether we were justified were raised before the war. And of all the Senate candidates at that time who were in, I was the only candidate who spoke out publicly against this war. I think that Now what we have to do is, in fact, internationalize this process, and what that means is that we're going to have to make sure that we don't have no-bid contracts going to Halliburton. That is not a good way of us attracting allies and investment. We have to put more money to the troops, but I would not put $20 billion in rebuilding Iraq unless we made sure that we had a clear exit strategy and unless we made sure that every dollar that was spent in Iraq was also spent here at home.
Okay, thank you very much. And Mr. Cox, you have a 30-second rebuttal.
I'm a fiscal conservative. I believe that we ought to be conservative with our money spent in Iraq, and I'm going to pursue that myself. As for the issue of whether we should have gone in there originally, nobody less than Dick Durbin and Tom Daschle and Bill Clinton were behind getting rid of Saddam Hussein in 1998. This was a brutal dictator who defied 18 different UN resolutions. I did not want to wait until a dirty bomb or some other device was dropped in the streets of Chicago to determine that we needed to get rid of this danger. We needed to do it, and we did it.
Thank you very much. And now you have a 30-second rebuttal.
Nobody doubts that the world is better off without Saddam Hussein. The question was, what kind of coalition could we put together effectively to limit his danger? And the fact of the matter is that we had no proof that there was an imminent danger, an imminent threat. There was no proof that there was a link between al-Qaeda and Saddam Hussein. And given that low level of proof, we could have worked internationally, and had we done so, we in fact could have had allies paying for the rebuilding process and contributing to the troops.
Thank you very much, Tillman. We appreciate it. See, everybody figured it out. That's how each round's going to go. And now, as you see, we kind of kept a theme, the theme the last round being the war on Iraq and the war on terrorism, and now we're moving to a new subject. We have to admit it was very tough narrowing things down to what we hope are the most important issues to the average voter. Jack Cossidy has a look at the topic, which we are certain fits this bill. Jack.
Robin, we move next to foreign policy, which, like the war on terror, has taken center stage since 9/11. But there are a range of issues and problems abroad that are independent of the war on terror. Americans are concerned about a range of foreign policy issues, beginning with those in the Middle East. The White House roadmap to peace is in shambles just months after it was unveiled. Palestinians and Israelis are involved in a continuing cycle of violence, with no meaningful negotiations now underway. On the other side of the world, North Korea is a threat, continually attempting to blackmail the U.S. with its potential to build and sell nuclear weapons. China remains a menacing presence, both economically and militarily. And Central Africa is a chaotic and often ignored region, with many nations there poised to export terrorism or war. Experts warn of a continued holy war with Islamic extremists in a number of regions around the world, from the Middle East to the Philippines and Indonesia. And just off the coast of Florida, Cuba sits isolated, its economy in ruins. But the Bush administration continues to discourage tourism or trade there. The United Nations is in its most precarious state since its formation in 1946, and the United States remains at odds with many of its allies over its policies in Iraq, the so-called Bush doctrine of preemptive military strikes.
Jack, thank you. Now, candidates, foreign policy becomes the topic, and you each will have 30 seconds for an answer. First up, Mr. Barack Obama. And your question is the U.S., do you think, a fair broker in the crisis in the Middle East?
You know, I believe that we have to support Israel, the only democracy in the Middle East. I think that the roadmap that had been set forward was a solid plan, because I think ultimately we have to come up with a two-state solution that allows Palestinians their legitimate aspirations, as well as security for Israel. But the only way that we can do that ultimately is eliminate the violence in that region. And I think it's critical that we encourage the best impulses in the Arab world and invest in those persons who, in fact, can provide that kind of leadership.
Thank you, sir. Robin?
Thank you. And now, Mr. Cox, the question is for you. Is the United States on a collision course with North Korea?
The North Korean regime is one of the most repressive in the world, and you can see that with the number of people that want to leave that country. We certainly need to stand up for freedom and peace. We certainly need to make sure that they live up to international commitments, that they do not buy or produce weapons of mass destruction. This is a small world now with the way that they have missile capability. We need to make sure that we're protected. And if it comes down to it, we may have to do it. I would like to do it on an economic and diplomatic basis first before we ever use military.
Thank you very much. Walter.
Mr. Dan Hines, your question is the UN, in your opinion, functioning in the best interest right now of the U.S.?
Well, my biggest criticism of this administration is that we have alienated the world community. The United Nations should be working with us in Iraq, in the war on terror, and we have made a grave mistake alienating the world community. The United Nations is not a perfect institution. We need to make sure that the United States uses its role to improve it. But we need the world community involved in all of our challenges in foreign policy, and the United Nations is a great vehicle to do that.
Thank you. Robin?
And now, Mr. Ryan, Jack Ryan, should Israeli settlements on the West Bank be dismantled?
I think that's really a question for the Israelis. I think our job is to make sure that we stand by the Israeli government. They're our only friend, our only ally, our only stable government in the Middle East. And how we resolve that process, or how the Israelis resolve that process, should be an issue for them. And our role should be to stand by them through thick and thin.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Ms. Washington, your question, is Central Africa a foreign policy priority?
You know, we can't go into every country, but certainly those who have a humanitarian crisis, those who have been our friends for long periods of time, we need to make sure that we stand by them. So I think it is a priority based on that crisis and where what we need to do at this particular time.
Thank you. Mr. Hull, is the U.S. involved, do you think, in a holy war with Islamic extremists?
Well, that's a good question. I think that the issue of 9/11 came about in a way that was terrible. The way in which we responded to it was good. I'm glad that we entered Afghanistan. That was perfectly justifiable. The fact that we went into Iraq, though, was not justified, and because it was preemption and there was not an imminent threat. The question is whether we're at war.
Yep. Good time to pause.
Thank you. And now, Mr. Borling, General Borling, how do you think the United States can repair its relations with France and Germany?
I think it was George Bernard Shaw who suggested that the trouble with the world is it's full of foreigners, and we unfortunately have to deal in that world. I've lived in 25 or served in 25 plus countries on five continents, and we find there is a great commonality of interest. In the end, we don't have permanent friends or enemies, really. We've got permanent interests, but our relations with France and Germany, I think, will heal over time just because it's in the mutual interest of the nations. We've got the power. We have to use it responsibly. I think our president, President Bush, is acting well.
Well, I knew just one more word is all I needed. Thank you very much, Walter.
Ms. Skinner, does China represent a threat to the U.S., either militarily or economically?
I would say the economic threat, Walter, of China should be more of a concern to the United States than their military threat right now. They only spend about $7 billion in terms of their military, but what they're doing is they're taking all of our jobs here. We have lost 2.7 million manufacturing jobs under the Bush administration. Those jobs are going to China, and it's not only the jobs. They're taking the technology with them, our wherewithal, our base that our living standards depend on, and if we do not re-engineer our trade agreements with China and the rest of them, we'll suffer.
Thank you.
Mr. Oberweis, should the United States allow free trade with Cuba?
In a word, yes. The more we can build trade with countries across this world, the more our economic interests are working together and the less likelihood we're going to have of military conflict. I think it's high time that we move forward to increase that trade. I think the opportunities and the timing is right now.
OK. Great. Thank you very much. And now it's time for our face-off question, our face-off round, and we're going to ask the two gentlemen, Mr. Gary Chico from the Democrat side and Mr. McKenna from the Republican side, to please come forward. And as before, our question comes from the audience, and Jack has our audience member on the question right now.
Robin, this is Donald R. Jackson from Peoria. Mr. Jackson, your question.
Good evening, gentlemen. North Korea has openly admitted that it has weapons of mass destruction and has inferred that it's willing to use them. My question is, what, if anything, should the United States do to disarm North Korea?
Mr. Chico, you have the first response. 45 seconds.
First of all, I'm not sure that they have weapons of mass destruction ready and poised to be used, number one. The only way you'll ultimately determine that is through dialogue and intelligence gathering. I would sit down directly with the North Koreans, not create some kind of situation where we have to have a sidebar, and engage in direct dialogue. I think you'll find that if we do that, we will find what their true interests are, which are famine, dealing with their hunger situation and their poverty. And I think we ought to do that very, very directly and not do this through indirect means. And we may even find that the threat isn't even as large as we may have thought, like we did with Iraq.
Mr. McKenna?
I think in any international situation, it's critical that we be clear about our objectives. We always seek to accomplish our objectives through diplomacy. I think I applaud this administration in these recent months, being clear about its objectives, seeking to accomplish them through diplomacy, but when not able to, they have taken action. I think because we've been strong and we've made strong decisions, our diplomacy will be more effective. And I expect that through diplomacy, we will resolve our situation with North Korea.
A rebuttal, Mr.
Chico. I don't believe we have been clear about what our objectives are with North Korea, and I certainly don't believe that we've engaged in direct diplomacy, not only in North Korea, but in very little places around the world. The Middle East, we start, we stop. Iraq, we have no plan for the after the war. Latin America isn't even on the map. We asked about Central America. It's nowhere to be found. I mean, I think we have to get very clear about what our objectives are worldwide and then engage very, very effectively with dialogue.
I disagree. I think we've been very clear. The President said 2 years ago, shortly after September 11th, that we have been wakened to danger and we've been called to defend freedom. We didn't create the danger, but we have taken action to manage that danger in many different situations. I think the President's been clear with us on his objectives. I think he's been strong in making the decisions. These are difficult decisions, but he's followed through on them, and I think it's that kind of leadership that will preserve peace for our country.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. We appreciate it. And thank you for that. That's a good question as well. Okay, now, if it weren't for all the turmoil overseas right now, our next topic would probably have been our first topic. Must be the money. Who is working, who is not, and whose economic policy do you really trust? Jack?
Robin, our next topic is the bread and butter issue of every campaign, jobs and the economy. Both have suffered declines in recent years, and Americans are very likely to vote their pocketbook next year.
The economy remains a problem. While the recession is technically over, it is not over for the unemployed. Nationwide, almost 9 million Americans are still looking for work, and here in Illinois, the unemployment rate is higher. The loss of manufacturing jobs here is one big reason why. Many of those jobs going overseas. NAFTA has priced many Americans out of the job market. They can't compete with low-paid workers in foreign countries. Much of the airline industry is ailing, American and United in particular, never recovering from 9/11 and years of mismanagement. The dot-com boom of the 90s is a memory now, and so are the heady days on Wall Street. Many middle-class American families are stressed and living on the edge of financial disaster. Two-income families that can't afford to lose either job, dealing with record-high levels of personal debt, and living in homes they can barely afford. This while the deficit is exploding in Washington, threatening to drive up interest rates and stall the economic recovery.
Thank you, Jack. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you that you each have 30 seconds to answer your question. Not that you've been bad, everybody's been really getting there under the buzzer. Again, the questions are going to be asked in the order previously determined by lottery. And so by that lottery, Mr. Borling, you are first this time. Do you support the Bush tax cuts, or should they be rescinded?
I absolutely support the Bush tax cut, and I'm glad the question comes back to me because I can finish my statement about Mr. Bush. His leadership is characterized by a great quality, and that's the quality of determination. Now, there have been some encouraging signs that the economy is turning around, but we still have a long way to go. In the end, Milton Friedman has suggested there ain't no free lunch. It's true. We've got to work ourselves out of this. The Republicans are working hard to get us out of this hole that 9/11 created. And, oh, by the way, for economy, Barack, you still owe me $10 for the campaign contribution that you said you'd send me.
Okay. I'd like to give you a chance to respond, but you're not next. Hold on. It's Mr. Hull. Do you support the elimination, Mr. Hull, of the inheritance tax? If so, why? If not, why?
First, I have to disagree with General Borling. President Bush is the most irresponsible, fiscally irresponsible president we have had in the history of our nation. He hasn't created jobs at all. You should build infrastructure to create jobs. The inheritance tax is ultimately fair. We need an income tax, an inheritance tax that is roughly the equivalent of what our income tax would. I support the inheritance tax.
Ms. Washington, how do you think we can stem the continuing loss of manufacturing jobs in this country?
We've got to make jobs a priority in this country. We are losing them. And we've got to make sure that our trade agreements are, they call it, say, free and fair. We've got to make sure that we keep jobs in this country instead of moving them all into other countries, and where the tax advantages are such, where corporations have loopholes and can take advantage of those tax advantages. We need to close all of those loopholes to make sure that we keep jobs here in this country.
And now Andrew McKenna. Has NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, had a positive or negative effect on American workers?
I want our country to be in a position where we export products, not jobs. I would have voted for NAFTA, but we've got to manage our trade agreements to see to it that they help us build prosperity in this country. With too many of our agreements, we're keeping our side of it, but our trading partners are not keeping their side of it. Before we proceed with any further trade agreements, I want to see that the ones we have are working for us so that we can get in a position where we export products and not jobs.
Thank you.
Barack Obama, what, if anything, should the government do to help the ailing airline industry?
Well, I think the first thing that we can do to help airlines and all industries is to roll back those Bush tax cuts that go to the wealthiest Americans, because I think that fiscal stability, even according to Republicans, is a good thing. And I don't think anybody can claim right now that we have that kind of fiscal stability. I think that with respect to the airline industry, I think it will improve when the rest of the economy improves, and I think to do that, we've got to invest in the infrastructure of this country. We need to build roads, bridges, schools. We can pay for that if we roll back some of those Bush tax cuts.
Thank you.
And now, Mr. Cox, should financial markets face tougher federal regulation?
They absolutely should be allowed to be free markets, and they should be transparent markets. I will be the only CPA in the U.S. Senate, and I'm going to be a leader in making sure that we do get transparency. I do want to respond to Barack, however, and make sure he understands that deficits are caused by deficit spending, not by not enough taxation. No country ever taxed itself to prosperity. And we do need roads and bridges repaired all throughout Illinois, which is why I oppose spending billions on O'Hare expansion, which I challenge Barack and the other candidates on the Democratic side to oppose as well.
Thank you.
Mr. Chico, will the federal budget deficit hurt the housing market with higher interest rates?
I believe it will. I think that the budget deficit, which is reaching record proportions right now, is going to wreak havoc not only on housing but a number of industries. And I echo what my friend Blair Hull said, that it's highly irresponsible to run up a deficit that high while giving tax cuts and while proposing $87 billion for our missions in Iraq and Afghanistan. I would scale back all of those things.
Thank you.
Mr. Oberweis, do you support the FCC's position on expanding media ownership for large companies?
Well, it's clear that we want open competition in communications and in media. And certainly what's been going on is the media market itself, the whole business has been expanding as more opportunities have come. So I think that competition is certainly good, and I think that we're going in the right direction there. There are so many more opportunities, so much more competition in the markets, that in fact I think it is okay to have a little more consolidation, which is what's been going on. So I think it's fine, yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Hines, are U.S. agricultural policies unfairly subsidizing American farmers?
I believe we need to support our farmers. I'm the only candidate who has spent the last 7 years traveling the roads of Illinois. I've been to every county in the state. I've talked to and worked with our farming community to make sure that they are supported at the state level, and I want to do that at the federal level. That means we have to support our farmers, and in particular, our family farmers. We need to create trade opportunities for our farmers so that they can export their goods. We have to realize that the agriculture community in this state is the backbone of our economy. As a United States Senator, I'm going to fight for the farmers and our agriculture community.
Thank you. And now it's time for our face-off round. We'd like Republican candidate Jack Ryan and Democrat candidate Nancy Skinner to please come up to the podiums. And Jack Connedy is with an audience member who has a question.
Robin, and this is the Reverend Teresa Deere from DuPage County. Reverend, your question.
Good evening. By profession, I am a human resources executive, and I have witnessed firsthand how corporations respond to Title VII. And as you are aware, Title VII of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, as amended, provides for penalties of a maximum penalty of $300,000 for violations of the act. If elected, what would you propose, what legislation would you propose or penalties to address violations of the act, and why?
Mr. Ryan has the first response. 45 seconds, please.
Well, I think everybody in our economy deserves a chance at a good job, at a way to provide for their family, a way to provide for their children, to give a home, warm clothes, good food for their families. So anything that violates someone's ability to do that on a fair and open basis, I think we should be very vehement against. And so I support making sure that we fully enforce Title VII. I also think another thing we need in our workplace is make sure that everybody has the chance at a quality education. And we know in Illinois right now, there's 250,000 children in Chicago alone that are going to failing schools. We make sure that everybody has a chance to compete in the workplace, either through enforcement of Title VII or making sure everybody has a good education.
Thank you very much. Now, Ms. Skinner, the question being, what legislation would you propose for the enforcement of penalties for the violation of Title VII?
Well, I would enforce Title VII regulations as I would all equal opportunities regulations in our economy. That's a must. We survive best when we band together as a country. And that's what I think, in terms of our economy, that we are not neglecting. We need to make jobs faster than we ship them to China, basically. We've lost 3.3 million jobs under the Bush administration, 2.7 million American or manufacturing jobs, 140,000 jobs right here in Illinois alone. When you ship your blue-collar jobs to China and your white-collar jobs to India, you don't have free trade. You have unemployment. So let's look back here at America and realize that all Americans need to be brought into this system, no matter where they come from, and we need to promote our manufacturing base.
All right. Thank you very much. And you have a time for rebuttal. I'll give you 2 extra seconds.
Well, I think the way to make sure that we have jobs staying in the U.S. is to make sure we have an educated workforce. And as I said before, we now have 400,000 children in Illinois who are going to failing schools. That is the biggest civil rights issue of our generation. These children don't have 2 or 3 years to get a good education. They need it now. We've got to make sure we provide every child with a good education now.
Absolutely, but I think it's time that we leave behind the No Child Left Behind Act on the scrap heap of bad ideas. In doing so, that was not a solution to providing the education that we need. In fact, Illinois experienced. We had over 200,000 students qualify, 1,000 positions available. That is not the solution. We know what works in terms of education, and it's smaller class sizes, it's paying teachers decent salaries, and it's rebuilding our school system.
Thank you very much. Mr. Ryan, Ms. Skinner. Now, moving on to the next round, I hope it doesn't seem like we're moving down to more and more depressing news, but of course, if it was all good, then who would care about the election? That said, Jack Connedy now takes a look at getting sick and getting old.
Robin, now it's on to the twin problems of health care and Social Security, two issues where it is not inappropriate to use the word crisis. Costs in both areas are skyrocketing, and there's no relief in sight. There is a health care crisis in the United States, and it's particularly acute here in Illinois. Almost 2 million state residents under the age of 64 have no health insurance. Nationally, the uninsured cost federal, state, and local governments some $35 billion a year. Most of that spent on people who are sick because of a lack of regular medical care. Even those with insurance find their premiums rising and their benefits shrinking. The healthcare system costs too much and covers too little. Millions of older Americans still have no Medicare insurance for prescription drugs. And Social Security is on the brink of crisis as well. The system will begin running out of cash just as the baby boom begins to retire. Within 15 years, the system will pay out more than it receives. By 2022, the Social Security shortfall will equal the budgets of the Departments of Commerce and Interior and the EPA. 5 years later, you could throw in NASA and the Department of Veterans Affairs. And polls show many younger Americans believe the system will be bankrupt long before they retire. With a dramatic drop in stock values on Wall Street, plans to privatize at least part of the program have gone nowhere.
Thank you, Jack. Our first health care question now goes to the Democrat, Mr. Obama. And the question is, sir, do you support prescription drug coverage under Medicare?
Absolutely. I think that in a country as wealthy as ours, there's no reason why every American should not have basic health care, and that's particularly true for our seniors. We could afford a full prescription drug plan under Medicare, but the one that's been proposed by the Republicans has a big donut in the middle of it, and the reason it has a big donut is because Bush gave the money away to the wealthiest 1%. I would roll back those tax cuts to make sure that we shore up Social Security as well as paying for a prescription drug plan.
Okay, Robin.
Our question for the Republican side starts with Mr. Cox. Should wealthy seniors see a cut or an elimination of their Social Security benefits?
No, I don't believe they should, because they paid taxes to go into that system. Social Security is a demographic time bomb, and I've worked very hard in this area. As a CPA and an investment advisor, I can tell, first of all, people that on the other side, that the stock market is down only about 10% from its all-time high. We need to give people, particularly minorities, the opportunity to save for their own retirement. I would work to try to provide private accounts for individuals. Take 5% of that 12% tax that we pay, put into a private account that would grow for retirement.
Thank you very much. Walter.
Mr. Chico, do you support universal health care in the U.S.?
I believe a wonderful goal for the United States ought to be to cover every American with some form of health insurance. The issue is, how do you do it? First, we deal with the 43 million who have no insurance today. We have to work with employers to offer a benefit, because many work but don't have the benefit under their employers. Absolutely, we must do this. This is the richest country in the world, and we ought to seek no less.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Ryan, must the Social Security safety net be saved at all costs?
I think it does have to be saved at all costs. We have to keep the promise we made to all Americans that upon retirement, they would get retirement income based upon what they paid into the system. So we've got to keep the safety net in place at all costs. Once that safety net's in place, I think we can experiment with ideas like choice and things like that, which might give younger citizens a chance to invest their money and get a higher return. We've got to make sure we fulfill the promise we made to all Americans that upon retirement they would have some income.
Okay, thank you.
Next up, Ms. Skinner. Are limits on medical malpractice suits a good idea or a bad idea?
Limits, as in caps, on medical lawsuits are a very bad idea. It is a fundamental right that we have access to the courts. Now, having said that, I believe that there are ways that we can work with the system to reduce frivolous lawsuits. A couple of ways that have been tested in states like Vermont and others is to make a mandatory pre-trial mediated session. That reduces the lawsuits, and also to ensure that there are some penalties associated with those deemed to be frivolous. We can do that without capping the fundamental right to access to the courts.
Thank you.
Mr. McKenna, should the Social Security tax be expanded for high-income taxpayers?
No, I don't think the Social Security tax should be expanded for high-income taxpayers. I think the important thing is to reform our Social Security system. We do need to guarantee benefits for those who have paid into it. We also need to provide people flexibility, particularly younger workers who are interested in having greater flexibility in the structure of the program. I want to see to it that we provide that so that we can have a good future for everybody.
Thank you.
Ms. Washington? Should insurance companies face tighter federal regulations to protect patients?
You know, I think insurance companies need to open up their books. We need to really see what's happening with and take on the real the insurance companies. So should they be involved in that? Absolutely. And we should make sure that we see what's happening with those insurance companies.
Thank you.
Mr. Oberweis, will Americans simply be expected to work longer before retirement?
No, I don't think they will. In fact, I've put forth a very specific Social Security program that I think will be sound for the government. It will still keep a safety net in place for all workers after age 72, but will allow some funds to be invested at the owner's option in an account which will provide for a higher standard of living from the age 66 to 72, based on reasonable normal returns. In a worst-case situation, retirement could be postponed if we had a dramatic, terrible stock market, but the odds of that are extremely low, and it should provide a benefit for everyone.
Okay. Right at the buzzer.
Mr. Hines, is money for the treatment and prevention of AIDS currently being spent adequate?
I think we need to invest more in the treatment and prevention of AIDS, both here at home and globally. My wife, Christina, who is a doctor, spent time in Ghana, Africa, on a medical mission and saw firsthand the crisis that is gripping that continent with respect to AIDS. We need to make a greater investment here at home as well. We have to make sure we have research that's adequate, but also preventative efforts as well. It's one of the major challenges in our health care crisis that is gripping this nation.
Thank you, sir. Now, would the Democratic candidates, Mr. Blair Hull, the Republican candidate, Mr. John Borling, please come up to the podiums. Mr. Hull, you will be the first to answer the question from our audience member, for which we go to Jack Connelly.
Walter, this is Mr. Willie Bell from Rockford. Mr. Bell, your question.
The prices of medicine is high and getting higher. If you are elected, will you lower those prices and make sure they continue to be low?
That's a good question. The real issue here is the corporate special interest in Washington. The pharmaceutical companies and the insurance companies have a stranglehold on Washington. The last time that we attempted massive reform of health care was in 1993 with the Clintons, and they were beaten down by all the special interests. We need independent people in Washington who will fight for everyone, not for the corporate special interest. Think of this. How could the pharmaceutical companies have convinced us that our drugs should be more expensive than they are in foreign lands? How did they ever do that? It's because they have a stranglehold, and politicians take their money. I will stop that because I won't take the special interest money.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Borling, your answer to that question?
Well, first of all, I'm glad that a Rockford native is asking me the question. Good to see you tonight. I think that this is an issue, and I'm an employer too, and paying an awful lot for each employee's health insurance, that we've got to tackle both from a legislative and from an executive standpoint. Now, we've taken some shots at this in previous administrations, and remember, tonight you're talking to a Senate candidate. You're not talking to a presidential candidate, or you're not talking to the good fairy. We've got to be able to do this in a way that we can afford it as a nation and afford it as individuals. I think that that combination approach, going for a system that all Americans would benefit from, and that is a program of accessible and affordable health care. I've got some very specific ideas how to get there. Having lived in countries that have socialized medicine, boy, we don't want that. It may sound good, but just don't get sick.
Mr. Hull, 30-second rebuttal to that.
Okay. Well, you know, one of the things about health care is it really doesn't work well in the free market system. And the reason for that is that we don't have choice. You don't have choice of where you go. You don't know what it costs, and you don't know the quality. So the free market system really breaks down in health care. And that's why we need to depend on our programs of Medicaid, Medicare, and why efficiency really does occur in the government system. There's no question we need affordable health care and prescription drugs for everybody. Universal health care is a right.
Thank you, gentlemen. Please take your seats.
No. One more rebuttal. One more rebuttal.
Unfair.
Oh, I fair to the Air Force here.
Oh, sorry.
I was going to comment only that the Y River report, which has just been issued, talks about a consumer-based medical system. I think it points the way ahead. I think this is a subject that the federal government can be in, but certainly not run, because Frankly, the federal government just collects money well, and everything else, government being a blunt instrument, is subject to critique. I just think we have to keep our feet rooted on the ground and expect the outcomes that we want as Americans.
Now,
there you go. Now, thank you.
Now, can now you may. Jack, we go back to you for a look at our next topic.
All right, Walter, we move now to some of the social issues, the hot-button topics that make headlines and often polarize Americans in ways that seem to make compromise impossible and confrontation inevitable. 40 years after Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech, many Americans believe the check to African Americans continues to come back marked insufficient funds. African Americans remain effectively segregated in many American cities, including Chicago, and continue to suffer from disproportionate rates of homicide, gang-related violence, and incarceration. And many African Americans believe the country owes them reparations for the ravages of slavery. Gay rights has emerged as another civil rights struggle in this new century. A recent Supreme Court decision striking down sodomy laws just a first step. Gay marriage and adoption rights have moved center stage, and many in the gay community believe that equality will come only with a federally recognized status as an entitled minority group. Abortion rights remain the third rail of American politics, more controversial now than any time since Roe v. Wade. And education is still a national problem. The No Child Left Behind Act remains unfunded, and disparities in income have created a public education system that is uneven and underfunded. Teachers' unions remain a powerful force in education, but often at the expense of local school board control. Poor parents still have no choice between public and private education, and private college tuitions continue to rise at a staggering rate of 10 to 15% a year.
Well, thank you, Jack. These certainly are hot-button issues. And, Mr. Borling, you get to go first. First question, do you support reparations for African Americans?
I think this is one of those tinderbox issues where you can get a lot of political pap pandering, posturing, trying to speak to specific groups to win loyalties. I just think the issue is terribly difficult. I think the debate will be healthy. If you were going to ask me tonight, I would not be in favor of the program because I think from an implementable standpoint, it would be a nightmare. And I have serious reservations, but we'll be willing to listen, we'll be willing to learn, and that's where I stand.
Thank you very much. Walter.
Ms. Skinner, should federal judges be held to a litmus test on abortion?
Well, Walter, I believe that our courts and the protection of Roe v. Wade right now hangs in the balance. This administration is trying to do just that. They are putting a litmus test before their judges, whether we know it or not, who do not support a woman's reproductive rights. And as the next U.S. Senator from Illinois, I will ensure that that right is protected. I believe we have settled that debate, and it's a divisive issue, and it is over. And I will firmly stand for those who want to see women's reproductive rights protected.
Thank you. Robin.
Mr. Cox, do you consider gay rights a civil rights issue?
I am not anti-gay, but I believe that we need to stand up for families in this country. Families are the bedrock of our society. We need to make sure that we use our resources in a wise fashion, and that is to support families. I think what two people do in the privacy of their home, they should be allowed to do, and that is fine. But I think what we need to do is have less litigation and have less conflict between us. Make sure that we use our resources for families and the aid of children.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Hines, do you support the elimination of capital punishment?
I believe that we need to continue with the reforms in Illinois and throughout the country to make sure that our capital system and our criminal justice system works for every American. I support the moratorium until those reforms take place. We have to make sure that this system works for every defendant, that they have the access to good legal counsel, that they have access to all of the investigative and research materials they need to provide a good defense. I believe that we need to make sure that those reforms are in place before anything else happens.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Oberweis, do you support local control of education, or should it be federalized?
Robin, I think that anything that we can do at the local level is always done best at the local level. It should not be federalized. I think there are lots of opportunities, lots of reforms that we can make to help the school system, such as providing bonuses and looking at education more as a business, the way a businessman would look at it, rather than as something unusual and sacrosanct. So I think we ought to be paying bonuses and helping schools improve, but it should be done on a local level. I think vouchers, I think No Child Left Behind is a step in the right direction. Homeschooling may be another answer. More choices for the parents.
Thank you, Mr. Oberweis.
Mr. Obama, do you support affirmative action?
As a civil rights attorney, as a constitutional law professor, I've worked to make sure that affirmative action is part of our arsenal to eliminate discrimination across this country. I think that is absolutely necessary because we still have an unequal playing field. And I think that anybody who walks through the corridors of power or travels through a corporate business knows that, in fact, we still have exclusion, both with respect to minorities and also with respect to women. So I think it's something that's still necessary, and to the extent that we...
Mr. McKenna, do you believe Catholic politicians should follow papal orders on abortion?
I think that it's a responsibility of every civil servant to follow their conscience. And we all have the same Constitution. We are called to serve that Constitution and to serve the people of Illinois. And it is incumbent upon all leaders to follow their conscience and serve that Constitution to the best of their ability.
All right. Thank you very much. Walter.
Mr. Hull, do you support gay marriage?
I support civil unions. I believe it's an issue of equal rights. We have, I think, a couple, whether they're gay or straight, should have the right for hospital visitations, for health care, and should be able to pass on their estates to their significant others. This is an issue that is broader than gay marriage. It's about equal rights and equal opportunity for all citizens.
Thank you, sir.
Now, Mr. Ryan, are there too many nonviolent offenders in prison in the United States?
Well, I think anyone who violates the law, whether it's for a violent act or nonviolent act, if the sentence calls for prison, ought to serve their time. And there are many offenses that aren't violent that certainly call for time being served. And so I'd look at it on a case-by-case basis. But I don't think the mere fact that's not violent means they can't go to prison if that's what the law calls for.
Okay. Thank you. Walter.
And Mr. Chico, is the No Child Left Behind Act a success or a failure?
It's a failure, unequivocally. If your mission is to improve the education of children throughout this country, then it has failed. What we need to do is leave local control where it is in the hands of the local jurisdictions, but we need to have funding help from the federal government. Choice is not the way to go, in my view, with vouchers. The reason for that is, you saw in Illinois, first of all, somebody said 200,000 children are in failing schools. I don't believe that. 400,000. The labeling is wrong. The legislation was defective upon its drafting. What we need to do is provide money and tools to local schools to get their situations corrected.
Thank you. Well, and in this round...
Well, let's talk about hot-button questions. I didn't think anyone could answer those in 30 seconds. You, ladies and gentlemen, you did very well.
I would agree with that. And you know what's good about it, in a way, is that you don't have the candidates beating up on each other on the same question. I'm watching their faces, and they don't really know which question's coming next to whom.
And weren't we smart thinking of these questions? Oh, we already admitted we didn't think of them, right? Okay.
Well, we all worked on them together.
Very good.
In this round, to remind you, one of the Republican candidates has dropped out. We have Democratic candidate, therefore, Joyce Washington. Since there is no rebuttal for this round, she will have 1 minute, 15 seconds to answer the question. Jack is standing by now with a member of the audience. But first, would you please come up to the podium?
And you just got this opportunity to have a minute, 15 by lottery. Again, it was random. Jack.
Robin, this is Helen Porter from Carbondale. Helen, your question.
I'm a social worker, and I've worked as a social worker for 25 years. I have two children, and I'm concerned about the education of all children. The Bush administration approved legislation, the No Child Left Behind, but they didn't appropriate enough funding. My question to you is, if elected, what will you do to ensure that the program is properly funded?
If elected,
I will certainly see that the program is properly funded. No Child Left Behind leaves many children left behind, particularly ones that look like you and me. And so we have to make sure that those things that are in that mandate are certainly fulfilled. And the only way we can do that is make sure that it is fully funded. There's certainly some other things that we need to look at, like Head Start and early Head Start, to make sure that our children are ready. But we can't keep building 22 prisons and our third graders can't read and write. So we have to make sure that that mandate is fully funded.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you very much.
The next question and answer segment, which will be our final round, will cover a variety of topics. We'll continue to ask questions thereafter until it's time for the closing statements.
But before we move on, as we mentioned earlier, we did have to narrow down the number of candidates taking part in tonight's forum. But that certainly does not mean that the rest of them do not deserve your attention.
Therefore, we would like to introduce you to and recognize some of the other candidates in this race for the U.S. Senate.
And of course,
Republican Antonio Davis Fairman is a 37-year-old entrepreneur from Hoffman Estates. He founded a voter registration and entrepreneurial education organization. He's also been named part of Success Magazine's Motivation Generation.
Estella Johnson Hunt, a Democrat. She is 60 years old and a public school teacher in Evergreen Park. Ms. Johnson Hunt is a published author and entrepreneur, and a wife and mother of five children.
Dr. Chirinji is a 38-year-old Republican.